So in this topic, we're going to be talking about building Azure VMs using ARM. And so first, I want to kind of dive down into what is created when you build when you create an Azure VM. There's a few different services that are created. So if we're talking about creating a VM, so this will actually create a VM here, and then underneath that VM, you will have, I'm going to call this a storage account, and that's where all your VHDs will be hosted, is in the Azure storage account. It can be a storage account that is already existing, or you can create a new storage account with that. And you also have your different items that you attach to the VM, so like your NICs and your NSDs. If you create a VM through the Azure portal, it will automatically create an NSG for that VM. But if you're doing it using an ARM template or something, you don't have to have that. That's an optional. But you also have a NIC, which is just an interface to the public internet. And then you also have a public IP address as well, which is that IP address that you can hit if you're going to RDP into that VM and use it that way. And you can, those are optional as well. You can take those away if in your ARM template if you don't want to. They're created by default when you're creating through through the Azure portal. And if Kale, if you want to talk about a few of the different scenarios around that.
Yeah, I think the one thing too to hit there is that think about it like a hierarchy, right? So in ARM, when our virtual machine is deployed, like Ed said, there's many different resources or resource providers that are involved there. So there's the virtual machine itself, but underneath that would be something like a storage account, because the VM depends on that storage account. He can't exist without a place to put his VHD. A NIC is attached to a VM. It can exist by itself, not attached to anything. But we can attach that to VMs, and then something like an NSG could be applied to that NIC. So these kind of build a hierarchy, and in ARM we have the dependency model such that it understands those dependencies and knows that hierarchy to say, that's why when you come into a resource group and say, I want to clean up this resource group, you can say delete at the resource group level, and ARM will say, I know how to delete this. I have to delete this first, and then this, and then this. It couldn't come in, just whack the storage account, and then go try to clean up the VM. It would crash it, and all kinds of things, bad things would happen. And so in that model, there's a hierarchy to remember that's happening here with these ARM templates. One thing to mention, so he had touched on, if we have a virtual machine here, and I'm just going to touch on one specific area here around networking. So we have a NIC, a virtual NIC that's attached to that, and that has our private IP, so let's say it's like 10.1.0.1 or something. And then we could attach a public IP, right? And we'll call that a PIP. And we can attach the public IP to that, and that maybe is like 63.something.something, whatever. So there's our public IP. Now that's interesting, you know, for us to be able to, and then we could have NSGs applied to here such that, maybe here, to basically restrict traffic flow, right? So that's interesting, but what's cool is like it's only one piece of the pie, right? So this is just one IP that we've attached there. What if we wanted to say, no, we want to actually have multiple of these? So let's say we had two guys here, and both of these guys have a NIC, and we want to treat them like a cluster, right? So over here, we would basically want to establish some sort of a load balancer, right? So in that model, we can do two different things. We can do internal load balancing, and we can do external load balancing. So with internal load balancing, obviously, we're going to be using this kind of IP range, right? We're going to be balancing over the internal IPs. It can only be hit by internal. And in that way, we can basically, if we had, let's say, an app server or something over here, and it doesn't need to go over the internet to access, maybe this is some sort of process or business process that's running in the background, it doesn't need to be on the internet. So in that way, this guy could basically call into that internal load balancer and basically do that operation for us. We could also do it through a public IP, right? So this guy could actually be bound to a public IP. I'll call it a PIP, but it's not. A PIP is really associated with a VM. And that actually surfaces a public IP that then load balances across those. The load balancers are interesting because they also have like health checks, so they can reach back into the virtual machine. Now, there's two different like things to think about here. When you're doing a load balancer, these health probes basically are going to probe back and see if the machine's good, right? So is this machine running? We can specify what that health probe is. So if it's a web page that we got to hit to say, let's make sure that web server's running and responding, that kind of thing. So we can do those probes back there. And then if this guy goes unhealthy, The load balancer will basically not direct any traffic to him anymore, and it will automatically just start directing all traffic to this guy. By default, it's a round robin, so it would, you know, go back and forth between these two nodes. So that's kind of interesting, you know, to be able to do those kind of things. But then people start saying, well, how far can I take that, right? To be specific, these load balancers are layer 4. So they can't go up in the app stack, like up into like SSL offloading, some of the layer 7 application level stuff. It can't control that. It can only just do a simple health probe to see if it's alive and then direct traffic to it. If you want to go higher, you know, up into application layer, like layer 7 on the OSI stack, then in that model, you're going to use the application gateway. So we have an item inside Azure called the application gateway that allows us to do things like SSL offloading. So in that model, basically, we would have essentially a load balancer there. That would be our app gateway. And we can do things like when the end user over here with their computer browses into the site, they could hit an SSL endpoint right here. And actually, we don't have to put certificates on these boxes, right? We could bind the certificate up here in the load balancer so that we can just continue to add nodes over here and we don't have to put that stuff in there. It will do that translation for us. So it does a translation between those two that says, hey, if you get something from SSL, terminate it here and then direct it to this portal in this virtual machine. That could be SSL enabled too, or it could be non-SSL because it's already internal at that point. So it's a different way to kind of manage your network flow, and it's very common for large-scale web clusters to do things like SSL offloading and some of those more advanced translation features that we can do up there in Azure. So it's important to understand that we can do internal load balancing, and we can do public, and we also have this app gateway concept that allows us to do a little bit more than what Layer 4 can do. As far as I pointed out SSL, but it also does other translations up there as well. And so that wraps the module on building VMs using ARM.